So let me just expand on that, tell you a little bit where I'm coming from. A lot of my research, the physics research, has to do with nanophotonics. This is our textbook, but I'm expecting many of you are not in that field, probably most of you, but some of you might be familiar with our software. So I'm co-author of a package called FFTW, which is a fast Fourier transform library. There's some nonlinear optimization software called NLOPT, a variety of electromagnetic simulation programs, MEEP and FAB and so forth. As Ralph mentioned, I happen to write the ERF function and related special functions that are used in SciPy. And in most of this is C or C++ software. But typically you'll also have a Python interface and interfaces for other high-level languages, MATLAB and Scheme and so forth. I love high-level languages, but I do write a lot of C code. And I have a confession here at a Python conference. I've actually used Python quite a bit, but more through the internal C API than I have of CPython than I have in Python itself. It's probably pretty unusual for people working with Python. And it's also a bit odd in a Python conference because I'm going to be talking about another programming language, not Python, called Julia. And it was started a few years ago, but the first real release was in 2013. At this point, they're up to 0.3. There's about 20,000 commits. It was started by Alan Adelman's group at MIT, and especially by Jeff Bezanz and Viral Shah and Stefan Karpinski. And at this point, there's a lot more developers, heavy developers to this. And when I first heard about this a couple of years ago, Alan Adelman was telling me he was working on a new programming language. And my reaction was, you guys are out of your minds. You're doomed, right? Nothing to do with Julia. It might be a very nice language, but this is the usual fate for all new programming languages. There are a lot of programming languages, some of them very nice, and most of them just fall into obscurity. They never catch on. And okay, maybe I've upgraded that to probably doomed. At this point, I'm up to it still might be doomed. But in the meantime, I've been having fun with it. And I want to tell you why I've been having fun with it. And I think it solves a real problem that I have with technical computing and high-level languages. And that is the two-language problem. And so here's the basic issue. So you really want a high-level. High-level languages are nice to work with. You want something you can work with interactively. You can do easy development, prototyping, exploration, and so forth. And that usually means, it usually means a dynamically typed language. And there are plenty of those to choose from. There's Python, of course. There's MATLAB is the granddaddy of these in technical computing, and GNU Octave is the free version of that. R, Scilab, if you're French. Some of us even like Scheme. But the problem with these historically is that you can't write performance critical code. You can't write your inner loops in these languages. They're too slow. So you have to switch to C or Fortran. At least for the inner loops, right? Maybe you can write most of the stuff in Python and then call to C code for the performance critical stuff. So for example, in SciPy, if you look at GitMaster, it seems to be about 70% C, C++, and Fortran. And this is workable. We've all done it. I've done it many times. I've written lots of C code. I like C. But going from Python to Python plus C or MATLAB to MATLAB plus C is a huge jump in complexity. And I'm sure many of you have been through this. I just happened to me, last year, I had a student, he prototyped something in MATLAB, got it working. Okay, now we want to scale this up to three dimensions. Oh, it's too slow. You need to rewrite it in C. And, a year later, after they learn C, they learn PET-C, they learn MPI, they learn all these libraries that you sort of take for granted or easy to call in a high-level language and really painful to call in C, then we have something working with the paper. And of course, it's the first C code they've ever written, so it's a crappy, unmaintainable C code. It's an annoyance. And now, of course, you could say, well, just vectorize your code. And that's another way of saying you should rely on mature external C, C++, Fortran libraries operating in large blocks of data for all your performance critical code. And this is very good advice, right? If there's a library that does what you want, that's if you're doing dense linear algebra, you're insane not to use LAPACK, right? I mean, it's just there's no way you're going to beat it unless you're a domain expert, right? So, but the problem is, of course, someone has to write those libraries, and some of the SciPy developers are in this room. And you know, eventually that person may be you, because you know, you're not going to work in scientific computation very long before you run into a problem that's either impossible to vectorize or awkward to vectorize, and so then you're faced with this problem. But the thing that people have realized in the last few years is that dynamic languages don't have to be slow. And there's been a lot of progress in JIT compilers, driven a lot by web applications. And there's now an excellent free open source JIT, LLVM. And so the poster child is JavaScript, which is amazing in modern browsers. I mean, it really achieves C-like performance. Of course, it's a terrible language for scientific computing. But it's amazing performance. They dumped so much resources into it. They've really got very good speed out of JavaScript. And there's a lot of other efforts to speed up dynamic languages. So for Python, PyPy is one of the big ones. Of course, there's Numba and Cython. But those really are still two languages, right? It's a second lower level language that happens to be sort of embedded in Python. And so Julia started out with the proposition to say, so what if you took a dynamic language oriented towards technical computing, but you know, a general purpose language, and you design it for JIT from the beginning? With the goal, you always, every step in the language design, you kept in mind the goal that you should be as high level as possible while staying within at least a factor of two of C speed. Right? You're willing to sacrifice a little performance to get high level, but not more than that, and hopefully better than a factor of two. And by the way, it turns out, as I'll show, it's actually easier now to call SciPy from Julia than it is to call it from PyPy, which is kind of an odd thing. So, today, I'm not going to convince you all to program in Julia and so forth. I'm not even going to give a detailed overview of all the syntax in the language. I'm just going to give a sort of a brief introduction, some of the key features, give some idea of how it gets its performance. And I really want to talk about how Julia is leveraging Python and IPython and SciPy and so forth to lessen the usual problem that new languages face, which is new language, you lose all your libraries. You lose all of your plotting routines. Everything, you know, it goes out the window. You have to rebuild that from scratch. And that's a really big sacrifice to make. And time permitting, I'll also talk about how we can go the other direction. We can use Julia from Python as well. So there's a lot of buzzwords. It's a dynamically typed language. It has lots of nice features, not all of which I'll talk about. You know, has something called multiple dispatch, which is a generalization of object-oriented programming. It has built-in metaprogramming facilities, so you can write code that writes Julia code quite easily. Direct calling of C and Python functions. It has coroutines, asynchronous I/O, designed for Unicode from the beginning. It has distributed memory parallelism built into it. User-defined types are just as good as built-in types. You can extend the promotion, conversion rules, and so forth. And in fact, most of Julia, since it's fast, basically, it's fast enough that most of Julia can be written in Julia. And you know, it has actually a pretty large built-in library already. You know, regex, all the linear algebra stuff that you expect from MATLAB or NumPy, most of the special functions, numerical integration, and so forth, and has a package manager to start with. So that's actually based on Git. So let me show you just a quick demo. So let me pull up Julia here in the REPL. This is the prelude, and you can do it's sort of the same kind of syntax you expect in MATLAB and Python and all of these you know kind of languages. You know you can make variables and I can make a random matrix. And say, you know, A/X and so forth. And already many of you are thinking, wow, this sucks, right? You've been going to Python, your Python tutorials and stuff in this conference, and you see these beautiful IPython notebooks. And, you know, here I am with this little command line thing, which would have been cutting edge in 1990 when, you know, right after GNU Readline was released. But you know, nowadays it's looking a little bit antiquated, right? So IPython has this amazing browser-based interface where you have the graphics, you have code and equations and headings and so forth. And so you can say, well, come back to me in 5 years once you implement something more modern. Because there's a lot of stuff to re-implement to get all of these things that IPython has. So fortunately, we don't have to come back in 5 years, and we don't have to re-implement it. And to understand that, you should understand something about how the IPython notebooks actually work, right? So there's several pieces. So when the programmer enters some, has the browser running that has the notebooks being displayed, and she enters some Python code, right? She's living in the matrix here. And she hits shift enter. You know, what happens? So the browser doesn't know what to do with that. It sends that code over HTTP to an IPython web server. Okay. That IPython web server sends that code, just a string, over another protocol called 0MQ to a kernel. That's all, the IPython kernel, also written in Python, that then executes that code. And then it gets the result, and it sends back the results, which could just be a string. Right? It could be an image. It could be HTML or something like that. And then the IPython web server takes those results, formats them as HTML, maybe sprinkles on some JavaScript, and sends them back to the browser, which displays them. And when you see this picture, all of this is going to be the same for Julia except for this piece. And so all we do is replace that piece that takes a string and executes it and returns the results, or with a well-defined protocol, with a Julia kernel, which we call iJulia, which again takes the code but now executes it as with Julia, sends back the results in the same format, and then displays them. And the fact that we can do this is no accident. The IPython folks, IPython started out very much as a Python-specific thing, but over the years it's evolved. And they've designed this separation of server and kernel and protocol precisely to enable the backend to be replaced. And recently, instead of recognition of the fact that this is no longer just Python, they renamed it the web server portion to Jupyter. So the kernel is still called IPython. If you're running Python, it's still called IPython. But the web server, the protocol, that portion, or the clients for this protocol are called Jupyter. Okay, so now we have Julia running on Jupyter. And so Fernando Perez of the IPython project was very nice and flew a couple of us to Berkeley last summer for the IPython developer conference. And we hacked for a week and got everything working. And with the help of Fernando and Matthias Boussonnier, who's here, and Minar K, and several of the other IPython developers. And then we can have something like that. So this is running in the web browser. Let me see, open this up. Okay. And so this is running it. It's the same usual interface. I click on this. But now there's a different icon up in the corner. So this is running Julia. And I can do the same kinds of things I do in IPython. I can make an array. You know, A is random 10 by 300 array. And I can do, you know, maybe I can solve a linear equation and maybe compute A primed A times A, just like in MATLAB syntax. And then compute maybe the eigenvalues of this, and take the error function of that, and have, you know, subtract 2x squared plus 4x minus 6. It has all the kind of usual special functions in linear algebra and those kinds of things that you expect from working with MATLAB and NumPy. And of course, it has complex numbers and arbitrary precision. So I can make a complex number with 3 plus 4m. Big of that turns it to arbitrary precision. I can compute the sine. And then it's, you know, or the cosine or whatever, and you know, it computes it with right now 256-bit precision. It's UNPFR, so you can set whatever precision you want. It has Unicode built in. All the strings are Unicode. They're UTF-8 encoded by default. So I have a little string with some Unicode in there. I'm doing a regular expression matching on it. So I'm going to match all of the things that are space followed by A to Z, one or more A to Z, and I got a list of matches. So like Python 3, you can have variable names that are Unicode. Okay, Julia actually allows a somewhat wider range of Unicode and identifiers in Python 3. So here I have a variable called alpha hat 2 primed equals 7. Now, how the hell do you type that? So if only I could just type the LaTeX and maybe hit tab, and maybe hit hat tab, and underscore 2 tab, and then prime tab, you know, and do that would be great, right? So yes, yeah, so you can do all that. You know, you can have a variable, maybe say I have h bar there, maybe you have an x dot equals this, okay? And also, unlike Python 3, all the sort of the Unicode math operator, the binary symbols for the binary operators are parsed as infix operators, just about all of them. So you can have user-defined infix operators. So here I've defined the much less than, you know, the backslash LL in LaTeX, right? And x is much less than y if x is less than 1/10 of y. And then I, you know, is 50 much less than 100, 5 much less than 100? No, you know, 50 is not much less than 100, but 5 is much less than 100. There's also, you know, you can type less than or equal to, but if you want, you can type LE, right? You know, the less than symbol and those kinds of things. So it has a bunch of sort of built-in Unicode things. My personal favorite is to do cron. So it has a built-in Kronecker product. And I can just, let me make this bigger, actually. Built-in Kronecker product, and I can do, you know, I don't know, I 3 3, or 2 2 O times, and now I have an infix Kronecker product. All right, for those of you who know what Kronecker products are. All right, so that's kind of fun. It's a cheap trick. It's like really easy to implement, but you know, it's always fun to show. So you can define functions. You know, I've defined a foo x is x plus 1, either in this form, sort of MATLAB looking-ish, or in a one-line form, or I can define an anonymous function. And and here's the thing. So now we're going to start to get into why can Julia be fast? So what happens when I type foo of 3? Okay, foo of x is x plus 1, right? So of course it returns 4. So what Julia does the first time I call a function for a specific argument type, in this case an integer, it takes that function x plus 1, which it just has symbolic key, and it says, okay, now assuming x is an integer, let's specialize all the operations. Plus is now integer addition. I know the result is an integer, and so forth. It partially evaluates it, basically, for the types. It calls LLVM, it compiles it to machine code, and it caches that. And then the next time I call foo with an integer, it just reuses the compiled version. And if I call with a different type, it compiles another version specialized for floating point. It caches that. And if I call another version, right, you know, with an array, right, it compiles another three versions cached in memory of foo. Specialized for different types, three compiled versions. And we can actually inspect the generated code. So for example, I can type code typed to see what Julia's type is. It basically spits out an expression with the type inference added. So it says, if I call foo with an integer argument, okay, so x is an integer, 64-bit integer, then it figures out, okay, that this is going to be called the add int function, and the return type will be an int 64, and so forth. And so you can figure out if its type inference is working. And you can even look, there's something called code native that spits out the assembly code that gets generated. And I don't know if any of you can read assembly, but this is pretty short. This is basically what a C compiler would spit out for f of x equals x plus 1. So, oops. Let me go back. How do I get back? There we go. So why can Julia be fast? And I really can't answer that question yet because I really should ask a more basic question. So is Julia fast? I've shown you a toy example, f of x equals x plus 1, but anything can compile that function to be fast, right? So, they have on the website for the Julia, they have a bunch of synthetic benchmarks, right, that don't test any real problems. They just have little toy things that test how fast is looping, how fast is recursion, and so forth. So, for example, one of these benchmarks is called Fib, which computes the 20th Fibonacci number by the obvious recursive method, which is not the fastest way to compute a Fibonacci number. That's not the point of the benchmark. The point is to testing is, can you use recursion for performance critical stuff in your language? And if you're in GNU Octave, the answer is no. So this is time on a log scale, so, right? So this is quite a bit worse than Julia over here, right? The Fib is someplace in the middle. And Fortran, the Fortran compiler is actually doing quite well. I think it must be coarsening the recursion somehow. Here's Go is about the same as Julia, and so forth. And So here's Julia. The performance of all of them is pretty good. I think it's normalized so that C is 1. That's the units here, I think. It's normalized so that C is 1. And Python is, something like Python or Mathematica or MATLAB, they're good on some things, right? So for example, the blue here is multiplying two random matrices. And all these languages are just calling LAPACK for that, of course. So of course they're the same speed, right? But if you're doing recursion in CPython, it's not quite as good. It's better, much better than in MATLAB or in Octave. But you're still sacrificing an order of magnitude here. And this is typical for these kinds of languages. And this looks pretty good. But of course, this is synthetic benchmarks. You could say, what about real problems? Right. So I'm comparing not like toy implementation to toy implementation, but like a highly optimized implementation to a highly optimized implementation of the two languages. Right. So, and actually, in my experience, Julia does pretty well there too. I'll give you two data points. So one are special functions. So special functions are things like sine, cosine, Bessel functions, error functions, those kinds of things. And this is a sort of a classic case that you can't vectorize well. Because basically, to evaluate a Bessel function, you look at x, the argument, and depending on where in the complex plane it is, you use some kind of different kind of polynomial or expansion of that. And so if you have an array of points and you compute a Bessel function, every point is evaluating a different formula. So you can't really vectorize it easily, not efficiently. Now, most of Julia's special functions come from the usual C Fortran libraries, because they exist, they work. Why reinvent the wheel? But occasionally, there's something missing, so we wrote something in pure Julia code. So the first thing I tried was actually, it didn't have the inverse of the error function. I could have dug up some Fortran code for this, but let me just try implementing in Julia. It's just, there's a table of like six rational functions you can look up in the literature, or maybe four different ratios of polynomials, depending on what x is, and you just evaluate those, right? So I implemented it in Julia, and I tried it, and I compared it to MATLAB's and to SciPy's for large arrays. So we're talking about comparing to the vectorized versions. And it's like 3 times faster. And this MATLAB's is probably Fortran code. I don't know what it's doing for sure. And SciPy's is definitely from the Fortran Cepheus library. Another example, recently we wanted to look at I re-implemented the polygamma function in Julia. And the reason was that the library we're using, which was the same as the one in SciPy, the C Fortran code, didn't support complex arguments. I wanted something that supported complex arguments. Implemented in pure Julia, the same code. The nice thing about high-level language, the same code could support real arguments as well as complex arguments. I tried it. And for real arguments, it's like twice as fast as SciPy. So here you should be a little suspicious. Right? How can it be faster than C or Fortran? Right? It's using LLVM, right? There's nothing magic about its compiler that the Fortran compiler doesn't have. And the reason is that in a high-level language, you can use techniques that are possible, but much harder to use in a low-level language. In particular, these are using some metaprogramming and code generations to basically inline the evaluation of these large polynomials. Whereas in the Fortran code, that's too much of a pain. And so what they do is they call a subroutine to evaluate the polynomial that does a little loop. Right? And the overhead of the subroutine call plus the little loop iteration versus just inlining the whole polynomial is enough to give you this ratio. And it's just, they could have done it in Fortran, but it's a pain, right, to do this kind of thing. Another data point that I know something about is FFTs. So this is a plot of speed. Faster is better versus size for complex FFTs, double precision FFTs. So FFTW and math kernel libraries are up here. They're a lot better than the other codes, but there's sort of an unfair factor of 2 because these things are manually using something called SIMD instructions. So they're hand-coded to basically use special SSE instructions that the other codes don't have. So if we take away that advantage, disable SIMD and FFTW, it's this blue line. FFTPAC is here. And the one that was written purely in Julia is actually comparable to FFTPAC. And actually, I think it actually can get really the same. There's some tweaks to inlining that I think will fix the performance. But this is one third of the number of lines of code that FFTPAC. It actually does more than FFTPAC. It handles arbitrary precision transforms and arbitrary multidimensional transforms and things like that that FFTPAC doesn't directly or at all. It's nice. And it's basically, again, using code generation. So it's sort of FFTW1-like. FFTW uses lots of code generation, but much more sophisticated code generation written in OCaml that spits out tens of thousands of lines of C code. But that's quite painful to do in C. It requires a lot of infrastructure. In Julia, it was quite easy to just spit out hard-coded transforms of small sizes and put them together to make larger transforms. So these are real problems. These are optimized codes. And it's doing reasonably well. So why can it be fast? Why is it fast? Why can it be fast is a better question. Because, of course, you can write slow code in any language, including Julia, right? But you can usually tweak it with relatively small changes to make it fast. And why couldn't Python do the same thing? Why couldn't the first time you call a function in Python, it knows the type of the arguments, it specializes, it calls LLVM and compiles it and so forth? And maybe it can, but it turns out your ability to compile things efficiently is a consequence of a lot of small language choices that are somewhat hard to retrofit, and sometimes they're subtle. So let me give you an example. So basically, to generate fast code for a function f of x, y, the compiler needs to be able to infer all the types of all the variables in f. So they can map them to hardware types. It can say, OK, store this. This is a floating point number. I'll store it in a register. This addition is a floating point addition. I'll just call an instruction. I can call specialized code for these things, rather than having to, every time I use x, check its type and dispatch at runtime to some different version of that function. Right? And at compile time, the compiler only usually knows the types of the arguments and not their values. And so it needs to be able to cascade this information to infer types throughout f and in any functions called by f. So if f calls g, it needs to also be able to figure out which compile g, if necessary, to a specialized version for those types. Right? And so Julia is basically designed very carefully so the type inference is possible as long as you follow straightforward rule, easy to understand rules in the code. And this, as I said, sometimes requires some subtle choices that are painful to retrofit, or would be painful to retrofit. So one of the key element, there's a bunch of little things that turn out to affect this, but one of the key things is something called type stability. And that is that the type of a function's return value should only depend on the types of its arguments. It's easy to explain with a counterexample. So in MATLAB, here's the square root function. Right? If you take square root of 1, it gives you 1.0, a floating point result, a real floating point result. If you take square root of minus 1, it gives you a complex answer, which is convenient, right? That's what the square root of minus 1 is. But this means that the compiler is screwed, right? Because if you have any non-vector code that calls square root of x in MATLAB, it can't be compiled to fast code. Because even if it knows that x is a real scalar, right, it doesn't know if the output is real or complex unless it can somehow prove that x is non-negative. And anything, not only the square root function, but of course anything that's touched by the output of that, also it won't know the types. And then it can't, it has to have two branches everywhere in the code. Is this real or is this complex? And so it's better to basically throw an exception for square root of negative 1. And if you want the complex answer, you should put in a complex input, square root of 1 plus, minus 1 plus 0. And this is actually what Python does as well. Right? It throws an exception if you do square root of minus 1. Okay, but here's, in Python, you have your own problem. So for example, a typical idiom in Python, this is running out of speed, juice, if you have a function that returns foo of x, it returns y, or it returns none if some exceptional case occurred. And it's not hard. If you just Google return none in Python, like I Googled in NumPy and SciPy docs, and it's easy to find functions that have this idiom. It would be better to throw an exception if you have an exceptional condition than to return a different type. Now, you can say, well, there's not too many examples of these things in NumPy and SciPy, so maybe these could be fixed, right? Here's something that's a little bit more common in Python, which is integer arithmetic. Right? So Python guarantees that integer arithmetic will never overflow. And it does that by automatically switching over to arbitrary precision arithmetic as needed, automatically using big nums. Okay? And that means that unless the compiler can detect that overflow is impossible, and there are cases where it can detect this, right? If you have a loop from i equals 1 to 100, right, you know that i is not going to overflow inside that loop. But unless it can detect that, then integers can't be, an integer variable in Python, the compiler cannot stick it in a register. Every time it does x plus 1, it potentially needs to call an arbitrary precision routine. And so the trade-off that Julia makes is it says, well, the default integers are 64-bit integers. Overflow is possible. Now, fortunately, now that we have 64-bit integers and 64-bit hardware, right, if you're counting things that exist in the real universe, like bytes or loop iterations or something like that, you're never going to overflow 64-bit integers. But if you're doing something like number theory or something like that, if you're computing a factorial of 100, right, you're going to overflow that. But usually, if you're doing number theory, you know you're doing number theory. And in that case, you explicitly tell it, I want to use a big int type. OK. So let me go back to some code. OK. So one of the keys to this kind of specialization, let's see. Is something called, maybe a little, it can be a little bit smaller, a dynamic multiple dispatch. And this is not an idea, this is not an idea that originated with Julia, but it's one of the, it's relatively rare in mainstream languages to have this. So to explain this, so think about traditional object-oriented programming. So you have an object type, some class that owns certain methods, you know, certain functions, and you typically call this via, you know, object.method, arg1, arg2. Right? That's the usual dot syntax. And what happens is, depending on the type of this object, the runtime system will then dispatch to different method definitions. So then you can have inheritance and have different object types that both implement methods, the same method in different ways, pass the object to a function that calls that method, and it will automatically dispatch to the right thing. Right? So it's dynamic polymorphism. So in Julia, the same thing, you spell it slightly differently. So you don't use the dot notation. You just say method, parentheses, object, arg1, arg2. And there's a reason for this. And if you spell it this way, you should notice something is funny about object-oriented programming, which is that why is the first argument special? Like, why should we just use the first argument to decide what method to call? Why not look at the third argument? Why not look at the second argument? Why not look at all the arguments? And that's exactly what multiple dispatch is, right? So multiple dispatch means that the runtime, when you call this, it looks at all the types of all the arguments and chooses the most appropriate one and calls that one. And a classic example of this is binary operators. Right? So if you do x times y, then what function you're going to call depends upon the types of x and y. If you're doing matrix times matrix or matrix times vector, those are going to be different functions. And you know, functions, and you really want to look at both of them. It's not like the matrix type, the first argument owns that method. It's a little bit unnatural. You want it to be owned by both. And so in Julia, I can type methods, star, and get a list of them. Oops, that's plus, you see. Methods star, and get a list of the methods for the function star. And there's 130 different methods for different types. If you multiply two booleans, or here's two complex, let's see. Where's, if I do, what's something that's really easily understandable? If I took, yeah, two complex numbers, here I can click on it. Let's see if this internet works. And good. Here's the implementation of complex multiplication in Julia. It's exactly what you expect. It's implemented in Julia, but it still compiles to fast code. It's just the obvious definition. And even multiplying two integers. So multiplying two integers basically calls down to some LLVM intrinsic that, you know, the mole int that's going to call some instruction, you know, some specialized instruction for that. But all the rules for all the types, including things like as basic as integers, are implemented in Julia, which is kind of cool. And at any time, if I want, and there's, you know, rules for different kinds of multiplying different kinds of matrices and other kinds of things. And since you know, the method doesn't belong to the type, it's something separate from the type, I can add new methods to a given function at any time. I don't have to make them a part of the type's definition. So for example, if you do string concatenation in Julia, That's done with star, not plus. I think the rationale was that plus is usually for commutative operations in algebra, and string concatenation is not commutative. But whatever. So suppose you really like plus, right? So I have hello plus world. I wanted to find plus for strings. So you can do that. To extend an existing method, I have to import it first. Import base plus plus, and I'll say, okay, if I do plus and I have two strings, then I'll actually concatenate them with a space. I'll make it a different concatenation operation, right? And now I'm declaring types here. The key thing to realize is that the type declarations here are not for performance. When I did my f of x equals x plus 1, I didn't have any type declarations here. The type declarations here are a filter that says, these are the argument types for which I want to call this method. Right? So they convey semantic information. It's not just an optimization. Right? And now, once I do that, I can say hello plus world, and it produces the string with the space. And now I can pass it, if I have any function that takes, actually, let me show the next thing. So this may look like some of you like C++ overloading. Right? In C++, I can make functions and you know, different argument types and then call it, and then the compiler picks the most specific one. The difference is that's done statically at compile time. Right? I can't add, I can't write a function in my library and then overload it later, after compilation in some separate unit, and then extend the functionality that way. Right? This is done dynamically. It's like object-oriented dispatch, not static dispatch. And so now that I define plus, I can use now strings with any function that requires a plus operation, for example, sum. So here's the sum function works on a list of things, or array of things, but any things that defines plus, sum will work for. And so I ran it on a sentence consisting of the quick brown fox jumped over the lazy dog. This is a famous sentence in typing practice. It contains all the letters of the English language. So it sums them, it reduces them with that plus operation. So it depends on the spaces. Yeah, so I mentioned that, yeah, it's like filters. And So let me get into the fun part now. So let's talk about how to call external code. And the starting point is calling not Python, but calling C and Fortran, and basically anything with a C compiled to a C ABI binary interface, right? And so just like C types in Python, or there's various fast function, you know, direct function calling things in Python, there's an intrinsic in Julia called ccall that you can just call an external C library. So here I'm calling printf, right? So printf, you know, just like in C types, when you call a C function, right, all it has is the binary of the compiled library. It doesn't know the types of the arguments, so you have to tell it the types. Actually, technically, there's a package in Julia called Clang that actually runs, since we already have LLVM, it actually runs the Clang front end as well, and it can parse the header file and pull out these things. But if you're calling it manual, I'll specify the type. So I specify the return type, the function name, printf, the return type, and the argument types. In this case, it's a pointer to char. Right? That's what printf takes as a string. And I'll pass it a string, and it will call it, and this has a side effect. You know, it returns the number of characters printed, and it has a side effect. It prints out hello world to the standard output, which got captured and sent to the Python front end. No, to the IPython front end, sorry, the notebook. And so here's another example that calls a function in a library. So I give it, instead of just the function name, I give it the function name in a library. Assign the sign function, libm. And it returns a C double, takes a C double argument, I'm going to pass it x. And of course, it gives the same result as the built-in sign, because the built-in sign is calling libm. So, I mean, I haven't done anything interesting here. And it automatically converts the types as necessary. So here I'm passing a floating point, which is this double precision floating point. This is the same as the C type. But here I'm going to pass an integer, but C call will automatically take x and convert it to whatever types are expected for the arguments, as long as there's a conversion function defined. So I can do that, right? And so you can do this in Python as well with C types and so forth. But if when you wrap a special function like sign or like earth in my case, right? In Python you never do this. You never call it directly. And the reason is, you know, you don't want to call ERF, whatever, in your inner loop in Python. You have to vectorize it. And the vector, you have to call ERF or sign on an array to make it fast. And that loop needs to be implemented in C. So when you wrap a function like this in Python, you have to write a wrapper routine that takes in a Python array, does the loop in C, and constructs the NumPy array output and spits it out. So Julia, fortunately, is fast enough that actually it's perfectly fine to call the C functions directly. There's a function, there's a macro. This is a metaprogramming thing. I won't explain it. But a macro that takes a function and generates the vectorized versions for me. And now I can pass it with an array. And it calls it for the array. And if you look at the native code for this function, again, we can look at the assembly output. It's just pushing the argument onto the stack and then pushing the address of the sign function into a register and then calling that and then popping the result. It's just what a C call would do, right? So there's really no overhead to a C call compared to what you would do in C. And using C call, then on top of that, you can build interfaces. And people have built interfaces to all sorts of libraries. Of course, LAPACK and ICU and HDF and so forth have been built on top of this in Julia. And it's quite nice. If you've ever worked with C types in Python, it's much nicer to write interfaces to C, to write the glue code in a high-level language like Python or Julia than it is to write glue code in C, right? If you've ever written a MEX file or the C side of the Python glue code. And so the same thing is implemented by a package called PyCall that I wrote, which calls libpython. So CPython compiles to a C library called libpython, which has a very well-defined C API. You can call to call Python routines and pass Python objects back and forth, and it tells you how to convert, if you have an int in C, how do you convert that into a Python integer? It gives you a routine to do that and so forth. And this is a low overhead way to call Python, because basically this is the same thing that your Python library is doing. When you write your Python code, it's calling the same things internally as well, right? So when we use PyCall, then I can just import Python packages directly. So I have a little macro called pyimport. Here I'm going to import the math library as pymath, and I can call pymath sine or, I don't know, cosine. And it calls it, returns the result, and it's like transparent. It looks just like a Julia function. And so let me break this down into lower level steps just to give you an idea of what's going on. So when you call something like pymath sine 3, right, so there's sort of three steps. So first it takes the argument, in this case 3, and it has to convert it into a Python object. So there's a function in Julia called pyObject, which converts it into a Python object. Then it has to has a reference somehow to this pymath sine function that it got. And then it's going to call it with this argument. And there's a function in libpython that says pyObject call. You can give it an object, give it an argument or a tuple of arguments, and it calls it and returns the result as another pyObject. And finally, you have to take the return type, figure out what type it is, and then convert it back into the appropriate Julia type. Right? So for example, let's break this down into steps. So the first step is calling pyObject of 3, and we get a PyObject, which is printed like this. I can look at the code for this. Let's see. Oops, no. I can do. There we go. Let's see if this works. So here's the code. It just calls a function pyInt from sizeT. It's just a C function in the API. Very, very easy. That you pass it the integer and it spits back a pointer to the Python object, which I then wrap in a Julia object that handles the reference counting and so forth. Okay, and so that's that. So to get the function handle, let me break that down into smaller pieces. So we pyimport the math library, and that calls a function in the C API called pyimport add module. You pass it the string, the module name, imports, it gives you a pointer to an object. And then given a pointer to an object, you can get math.sign. Now, one slight annoyance is that currently Julia doesn't allow you to overload the dot. So you can't do math.sign. So the syntax I'm using is math bracket sign. So use brackets instead of dot. That'll go away in a future version of Julia. But for now, it's a minor annoyance, right? You use brackets instead of dots. to look up attributes of objects. I get the sign attribute, which is the the reference to a pi object, which is actually built-in function sign. This is just the wrapper string that Python returns. I'm using that wrapper, the wrapper function to print it, basically. And then the lower level thing is I do pi call sine func. I give it the return type I want, pi object. I pass it the argument, and it returns the argument. And then given the return value, if I know the type, I can convert it. Otherwise, there's something called, I just find a special type called pi any, oops, which basically looks at the type, says it figures out from Python, asks Python what type it is, basically, and then converts it to the corresponding Julia type. And so all of this is going on under the hood when you do pymath.cosine3. So most of the time you don't need the low-level stuff, but it's there for cases that are more tricky. And so that's great. And so what happens when you pass an array? Right? So if you're calling you have some library and you pass an array of a billion elements, right? You don't want to take that array and convert it to a Python version of that, so you have two copies of this enormous array in memory. Right? So it doesn't do that. So if I make a Julia array and I type pi object of that, it converts it into a Python array by actually just wrapping the same data in a NumPy array. So it's creating a Python object that's a wrapper around the same data. So there's no copying of the data. And so you can see that if I change the upper left A11, the upper left element of A to 17, and then I print out the Python object, you can see that the Python object, its upper left corner, also got changed to 17. It's the same memory. And then if I call like a NumPy function or something like that, I just call the random I imported NumPy, and then I called some financial function, something rate of return on X. Then it gives me the value. It passed the data without making a copy and got the return result. And there's a few other wrappers, but going both directions, you can wrap arrays in shared objects without making copies. You can do the same thing with another large data structure you might have is a dictionary type. And so PyPol gives you a type called PyDict, which basically makes a Julia dictionary type, a subclass, that's actually a wrapper around a Python dictionary. So I can use the Julia syntax it looks just like the Python syntax, to basically set elements of this dictionary, which is now maps hello to 7 and 23 to goodbye. And then I can pass this to Python. Of course, it's the same object, there's no copy. And just for fun, I did something different here. I called pyeval, which I can just give it an arbitrary Python string, ask it to evaluate and give me the result. So most of this stuff is not done by passing string. When people see PyCall, the first thing that they think of is there's the Python executable running, and I'm talking to it over a pipe, and I'm sending it like a string of a program, and then it sends me a string, and I parse that. That would be insanely slow, right? So normally you don't want to do this, but just for fun, you can. So here I make a comprehension, x for x in dict keys. And dict is a local variable here, and you can define a local variable on the Python side just by passing a keyword. And so it says D, and of course dict, the keys are just hello and 23. So a more tricky thing is passing functions. So suppose I define my foo of x to be x plus 1. And I type pi foo, I get pi object foo. It actually converts that into a Python function that when you call that Python function with, say, 17, it calls back to Julia, gets the result, converts it to Python, and then does that. So for example, if you want to call functions in SciPy for optimization or root finding or these kinds of things, right? Typically, you're finding the root of an equation, you pass it a function, right, that gives you the equation. It's called a higher order function, or numerical integration, any of these kinds of things, right? So we can do that. So for example, suppose we want to solve a transcendental equation. We want to find a root of f of x equals cosine x minus x. I'll define the function f of x in Julia. Just so we can see what it's doing, I'm going to define I'll put a print line statement in there that prints every time it's called, it'll print where it's being evaluated. I'll pi import scipy op dot optimize as SO. And scipy dot optimize as a Newton solver called Newton. So I'll say SO dot Newton. I'll pass it the Julia function. You pass it an initial guess. Let me do different, I don't know, different initial guess. I don't know. Okay. And it returns the root, which is 0.73 whatever. But you can see it actually called back to the Julia function. This is a little bit trickier to do, right? There's no function in the CPython API. There's a function in the CPython API given an integer, an int, right? Give me a Python object. But there's no function in the Python API given a Julia function, give me a Python function, right? So what you have to do is the same way. How would you, for those of you who know the CPython API, if you have a C function and you want to pass it as a callback to Python, what would you do? What you do is you have to define a new Python type in C, on the C side. And you would, and that's, that works by creating what's called a PyType object struct in C. Okay, it's a big struct that basically defines the type. It has little fields for all the different methods. And there's a field called tpcall that's a pointer to a C function pointer. And if you make that non-null, stick something in there, then it's like overloading the call method on the Python side. And then when you call that function in Python, it'll call that C function pointed by the tpcall pointer. So basically, we do the same thing. In Julia, I create a PyType a type object struct, the same struct. And in the tpcall sock, I have to stick a C function pointer. But how do I get a C function pointer? Well, that's not a C function. That's a Julia function. Right? So what is a C function pointer? It's just a pointer. This is the address of the machine instructions for that function. But Julia has that, right? When I said when I call f of 1, it compiles f with LLVM to machine code, and somewhere in memory it has a block of machine instructions, and it has a pointer to it someplace. So we just need Julia to give us that pointer. And so there's a function in Julia called C function that does that. So you give it the function, you give it the types that you want, because C function pointers are more specific on types. Okay, and it compiles it if necessary, if it hasn't been compiled yet for those types. And then it gives you back a pointer, a void pointer, to that block of machine code. It says, go ahead, knock yourself out, do whatever you want with this pointer. And usually what you do is you pass it, if you're calling a C library that expects a callback routine, right? You need to pass a C function pointer. This is how you call a library and have it call back to Julia. So this is used in other cases, to call optimization libraries and other things passing callbacks, and it's also implemented in Python. So, finally, let me show you one of the first really useful things we did with this is to call matplotlib, because it's really hard to develop a full-featured plotting library. And so now I have a little wrapper called pyplot. It makes it a little bit nicer. And so I can say make a lin space. I can say plot x. I give it some function, just like the pyplot commands. Give it a title. Hit shift enter. And here, let me make it smaller so you can see. And here it is. It showed up. So it's passing the arrays without making a copy to matplotlib. Matplotlib does whatever. And we call matplotlib, say, give us an image back, a ping image, whatever. And then we send that along to the Python front end. And so you have all the plotting routines. I can make a 3D plot. I can even do, you really have the whole matplotlib API. So here's a more detailed example that uses the xkcd function to make an xkcd style plot in Julia. You have to call, you have to get an axis object here. And then you have to annotate and x set, x lim. So again, we're using brackets instead of dots, but otherwise the syntax is the same. And we can just do it. We can call everything. And just another example, there was a nice demo a couple days ago of the scikit image package. It's way more full featured than any kind of image processing library in Julia. But since we can call it directly, that's no loss. So I imported the skdata package. I got one of their example images. It returns an array in Julia, and then I can plot it, right? It still has xkcd plots turned on, right? Here I'm calling a function called equalize adapt hist that like enhances the contrast over here in one of them. I can also call a function that does something called otsu thresholding to calculate a threshold of the image and plot that. And I get that. Oops, you can't see it. Let me do maybe a different CMAP. There we go. Now you can see it. Right? And it does that. So all of that is available. And the last thing I want to show, so Python 2.0 introduced interactive widgets. And so Julia recently, this is thanks to work largely by a really good Google Summer of Code student, Shashi Gowda. So Julia, the syntax is to say manipulate for n equals 1 to 100, and I give it some expression, in this case random matrix, and I can just now drag it. I'm going to change the size of the matrix. Or there's a package called color in Julia that can do color matching and conversion between different color spaces and so forth. But it can also just display colors. So here I'm going to display a lin space, a linear gradient from RGB 000 to RGB RGB, where the RGB are defined by sliders. And so, and the number of points is defined by a slider. And so I can drag these and change the colors. I can also make interactive plots. So I'm going to do a little interactive plot. I have a plot function. And here's, let me make it smaller so we can see what's going on. I can drag this, oops, and changes the plot parameters. I have a text box for the label in there, and all these kinds of things work. Another fun thing here is using SymPy. So what I'm going to do is I'm calling SymPy, so the symbolic algebra package. I'm going to make a symbol x, and then I call SymPy.diff sine of x squared, and I take the nth derivative, and n is a slider, and then it does the equations. So I think I'm about out of time there. So the upshot is, it's fun. You don't lose your Python stuff. You know, new languages are always a risk, right? So it's still a kind of Wild West feel in Julia. You know, every release has like major new features, and they don't hesitate to break compatibility if they find a design flaw in the language still at this stage. But you know, it's maybe not doomed. Right? And like I said, in the meantime, I'm having fun. So let me end with acknowledgments, especially the Julia core team, of course, that I already mentioned. Also, the IPython developers have been really, really helpful in getting the IPython integration, the widgets, and so forth. So Fernando Perez, Matthias, and Minar K. And also, I should acknowledge Shashi Gowda, this fantastic Google Summer of Code student that added all the plumbing to hook up with the IPython widgets. Thank you very much.
Right. Thank you, Stephen, for an excellent keynote. Any questions for Stephen?
Hi, thanks for the talk. I had two broad questions. The first one is, can you embed Julia?
Can you embed Julia in Python, you mean?
Yes.
Or call Julia from Python, you mean?
No, not just call, but let's say, you know, maybe you have a big Python application and you want to use Julia for calculation. Can you actually embed the Julia interpreter or whatever inside Python? Let's say you have a large Python application with a GUI.
Yeah, so I mean, something like this, for example. So let's say from Julia, import Julia, and then also initialize it, and then that's kind of slow for some reason. Okay, then I would say jl.sum 1, 2, 3, 4, like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a package called byJulia. It's still a little, it's not wrapped by a pip package or anything yet. But the nice thing is, the way this works is there's almost nothing there because all the work is being done on the Julia side. So when you say JL.sum, it's actually calling PyCall to take the Julia sum function and wrap it in a Python object. And it's calling PyCall to do all the transformations. So what that means is that on the Python side, you can do everything you can do for calling Julia. You can do everything you can do for calling Python from the Julia side. It works reciprocally because all the work is actually done by the same package.
Okay, thanks. So the first question. And the second question is, you mentioned at the beginning of your talk that maybe there could be some things that are done on the Python side to make it easier for Julia to use, or like some efforts that could be done on the scientific Python side to make the communication easier between the two languages. And do you have more details, or
there's not? Did I say that? I don't know if I said that.
Maybe I misunderstood. What
so I mean, from most of the stuff on Python, the Python side works. You know, the difficulties are always things that sort of get into like more deep in the plumbing, right? Things that have deep hooks into IPython, right? So getting Matplotlib working was more of a pain because IPython actually had to do quite a bit of work to get the IPython PyLab mode. It had to write its own backend for Matplotlib, and to get if you want Windows to pop up and be interactive, it had to write its own event loops. So I actually had to redo that stuff on the Julia side to get a Julia event loop. I didn't write my own Matplotlib backend. I just took the existing Matplotlib backend and just monkey patched it. With Julia code, which is kind of fun. So I assigned the draw if interactive function in Matplotlib to point to a Julia function that does basically it queues the figure for display in iJulia. So occasionally you see things like that. I mean, the frustrating thing about Python, I've had with Python, the most frustrating part about calling Python and Matplotlib and some of these things in general, has been how to initialize it. Right? It's so hard to get the path set up correctly, to figure out the correct backend for Matplotlib, and some of those things I think are a bit unnecessarily hard. I still haven't gotten Canopy to work, right? We mostly recommend Anaconda. Like Canopy, it works fine if you're using the Python executable, but if you use libpython, like there's some hidden path someplace that has to be set up, otherwise you can't import any modules, and I haven't figured out what that hidden path is. So those kinds of frustration, but those really don't apply to most Python packages.
Me too, I have a couple of questions. What about how memory management works between the two languages?
Yeah.
And well, the other one is about threads.
Yeah. So memory management. So it depends on which. So it depends on which way you're going, right? So suppose I take a Python object and I make a Julia wrapper around that. So then the Python works, but memory management works by reference counting. So the Julia wrapper just increments the reference counter. And then when it gets garbage collected, so Julia has a mark and sweep garbage collection, not reference counting. So when the Julia object gets garbage collected, it calls a finalizer that decrements the reference count.
Okay.
So when you pass a Julia object to Python, they're sharing memory like one of these arrays. Then you have to make sure that the Julia object is not garbage collected before the Python object Python is done with that object. And that's when I'm constructing my own type, like I am with function, that's easy because I just put a destructor in one of the call slots, so that gets call. So Python will call that when it's done with the object, and that destructor tells Julia to get rid of it. For NumPy arrays, I'm using weak references to achieve the same thing. But yeah, but it's basically pretty straightforward. The other object was about the question was about threading.
Threading.
Yeah. So. So right now, the Julia does not do shared memory multi-threading. It has light green threads, coroutines, that use mainly for asynchronous I/O, but the parallel model is distributed memory, where you have separate processes. However, there's a patch that's about to land that enables multi-threading support in Julia. And so Julia doesn't have like a global interpreter lock or anything like that. I mean, it's not interpreted. It's calling just compiled code. There are some portions of the libjulia, of the Julia implementation, that are not thread safe, namely the memory allocation. So right now, the multi-threading is only used going to be used for like if you're calling sine of a big array, you just want to parallelize that over multiple threads or something like that. That doesn't require any memory allocation in the multi-threading. Then that will multi-thread. But things that involve memory allocations. That'll have to wait until we get a thread-safe garbage collector, which will take a little bit longer. But yeah, that's where that stands.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Here is one more question.
Hi, Steve Brazier here. What's so special about the dot operator in Julia that you can't override that? What's that used for?
But it's just... nothing. It'll probably be, the next version will probably be overridden. It's just not implemented as a something you can override. There was some philosophical debate about whether people want to implement it, because right now there's a question of style, right? So right now the way you say the length of an array in Julia is a length, right? Once you can override the dot, you could also do a length. I'll be unhappy if like half the libraries use one style and half the packages use the other style. But I think the consensus is that dot overloading is going to be implemented. It'll just be recommended for specialized use cases, like calling foreign, Python or Java, or there's some other cases where overloading dot is really, really useful. So. But yeah, it's not. There's no particular reason. It's just that wasn't implemented initially.
All right. Last question from Gail.
Hey, thanks a lot for the talk. Quite clearly, well used tracing JITs are disruptive technology. Mm-hmm. So back when I switched from MATLAB to Python, I mean, the big deal for me was switching from specific. A domain-specific language, which was a scientific language, to a general-purpose language. And that was a huge deal for me, because any realistic application will need things like web services and graphical user interfaces, which you actually do need. And I mean, when you're using IPython, you're actually tapping into Tornado, which is actually, I believe, built by Facebook. So you're tapping in a huge ecosystem.
Yeah.
So my question would be, is there any way to try to get these technology in something that is not only for scientists, so that we can benefit from a bigger ecosystem?
Yes. Yeah, so Julia is a general purpose language. I mean, the thing is with new programming languages, if we look at them historically, right, it's very hard for new programming languages to catch on unless they pick a niche to start with and expand from there. So, the niche that Julia has picked to expand from is technical computing. But it's definitely designed with general purpose computing in mind. So they have full asynchronous I/O, for example, from the beginning. And lots of regular expression stuff and stuff to control processes and pipes and other kinds of things that are not traditionally technical computing. There is already a pretty nice wrapper for GTK in there. There is actually a wrapper for Qt that works by calling PyQt at the moment. One of the traditional problems with Qt is that Qt is a C++ library, and doing direct function calling of C++ from other languages is always a pain, because a C++ function doesn't actually, it has some kind of compiler-specific mangling and so forth, and might use templates, and all these things that are very C++ specific. Actually, it looks like that will be fixed. There's a package for Julia coming out in the next version that will allow you to call C++ code directly, including instantiating templates and all sorts of things. And it works by basically calling Clang to generate the appropriate code. Hopefully with that, it'll actually get native Qt wrappers. But yeah, the GTK wrapper is actually, I haven't used them, but people seem to think that they work pretty well. Certainly, for those of you out there who are experts in some other domain, right, like web servers or something like that, I think we would love it if you would take a look at Julia and say, is there something that I would really need in this domain, that's missing from, not just from a standard library, but a language feature that's really awkward in that domain. And if there is, hopefully there isn't, but if there is, at this point, they're pretty open to adding features to the language or changing how things work, even breaking backward compatibility if that's necessary. But like I said, I think that you'll be pleasantly surprised that there are definitely Julia developers that really understand I/O and that really understand some of these other features that are not traditional scientific computing. And it shows in some of the implementation of the OPLs. Yeah, there is actually a package to call R from Julia. Yeah. I haven't used it, so I don't know how well it works. So R is another one of those languages that I've only used via its C API, and then the C API of R is much less nice than Python's, and it's much less documented. So it's one of those languages where, in order to call it from C, you end up having to read the source code a lot to figure out, oh, how do I create this type? So that's a bit of an obstacle. But yeah, there is an effort to do that. It's not as advanced as PyCall is. There's also something to call Java from Julia, and there's even one to call MATLAB from Julia as well.
All right, Stephen, thank you very much.